Amen.
So in 2012, God saved me. He saved me not just physically from myself and my addictions, but secured me eternally for himself and by himself. He does not need me, nor did he save me because of anything he's seen in me. Because of his grace and mercy and display, and to display his power, he literally saved my life. Psalm 106:8 reads, "Nevertheless, he saved me for his name's sake, that he might make his power to be known." My mom was a single mother. My dad was an alcoholic and lived in San Francisco when I was growing up. I did not see my dad much growing up, but the few times that I did, all that he would talk about was the Bible and Jesus. I started using drugs when I was in sixth grade. The last thing that my dad said to me when I was talking on the phone in California was, "Cole, the next time you come see me, I'm going to show you what drugs do to people." My dad didn't need to show me the slums of San Francisco because he showed me with his own life. He died when I was 17 because of an alleged drug overdose. I started using and selling meth around the same time when I was 17. I did not believe in God. My idol was Marilyn Manson. I believed that the only reason the Bible existed was to keep morals in society. Over the next few years, I was in and out of rehab. Now, the first time I reached out for help from God was in a psych ward in Cambridge after a methamphetamine-induced psychosis. I asked the God that I didn't believe in to get me out of my psychosis. Within 72 hours, my head did clear up. 2005, after a night of heavy drinking, I crashed my work truck and fractured my spine in three places. I had to learn how to walk again. It took about 7 months before I was healed. Through the injury, I got a taste for pain pills. This would become my new addiction. After more secular 28-day failed treatments, I fast forward to 2012. I was taking Suboxone from a methadone clinic as a result of my pill addiction. And because I was an addict, I was on the highest dose possible. I was also smoking what was around then, Spice or K2. It was a synthetic marijuana, and I was using it like cigarettes. I was sick physically, mentally, and I wanted out. I was finally done, and God knew it. After 10 years of drug and alcohol abuse, it was time to stop, and my battle had just begun. I called the methadone clinic and told them I wanted to taper off of the Suboxone, but the taper was too slow. It would have taken at least a year to get off of, so I just quit cold turkey. I was entering the biggest battle of my life. A day or two after quitting, I was driving to the casino. My delusion had just started because of the withdrawals. A secular rapper was on the radio, and towards the end of the song, he said, "Let go and let God deal with it." Those words, for some reason, sunk deep in my soul. At the same time, the sun came up from behind a cloud, shined bright on my face, and I surrendered my life at that moment and cried out to God for help. Psalm 107, verse 5 and 6, it reads, "Hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted in them. Then they cried unto the Lord in their trouble, and he delivers them out of their distress." Verse 12 and 13, "Therefore he brought down their heart with labor, and they fell down, and there was none to help. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them out of their distress." 18 and 19, "Their soul abhorred all manner of meat, and they draw near unto the gates of death. Then they cry unto the Lord, and he saveth them out of their distress." And this one's my favorite. 27 and 28, it says, "They reel to and fro, stagger like a drunken man, and are at their wit's end. Then they cry unto the Lord in their trouble, and he brings them out of their distress." Something changed that day in 2012, but my behavior did not. The following days, I lost my mind. I became extremely narcissistic. I thought I was the center of the universe. I blamed society and the world for my problems, and I was going to take out my self-righteous anger on it. I went on a delusional rampage. I ended started going to the Bible study in jail just to get off the unit. After 3 months, I was furloughed out of the jail in the Salvation Army Rehab Center in Minneapolis. Throughout the jail, I had the words, "Nothing is impossible," ringing in my head. When I arrived at the Salvation Army, one of the first things I read was written on the wall, and it was Luke 1:37, "With God, nothing is impossible." This was the first time I recognized the Lord speaking to me through His Word. The Salvation Army had me in something called work therapy, and after about 3 months, they put me on a bus and sent me out to the stores. I was sent to the same strip mall that I had my first job in, which is that strip mall right over there. And my first job was for Cup Foods, now it's Jubilee Foods, the bagel. I walked out to the back of the mall, and I had a kind of flashback from when I was 16 years old again. I had realized that the Lord had given me a fresh start. At the end of the day, I would sit at the bus stop and wait to go back to Minneapolis, this one right over here in front of Walgreens. In front of me was this big church. For some reason, I never noticed in all the days of my addiction. The Lord had taken my blinders off, and I was looking at what was to become a huge part of my restoration and my relationship with Jesus. In the time leading up to be able to share with everyone this morning, I had some time of self-examination. 8 years ago, God changed me, but I do not want to pretend that I'm perfect. Sometimes this walk is 2 steps forward, 1 step back. Sometimes it's 3 steps back, 1 step forward. What I was thinking about this week was Jesus' words to His remaining disciples after many had walked away. Maybe this morning the Lord is asking someone here this question as well. Are you going to leave too? The cry of my heart this morning is the response of Simon Peter, "Lord, to whom will I go?" When life is difficult, when I'm overwhelmed by my failures, do I run to a shrink? No. Do I find the best self-help guru to read? No. Where do I go? The same one who forgave me, restored my sanity, and gave me a new life is my only hope in this life and the next. Outside of Christ, there's only meaningless vanity, chasing after the wind and death. Then Jesus said unto the 12, "Will ye also go away?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life." I believe that with every part of my being. I believe that. Thank you guys for letting me share.
If you have your Bibles, will you please open them with me to the book of Acts? As Andrew mentioned, we're going to be in Acts chapter 4 today.
Thank you, brother.
Let's turn to the Lord to begin. Father, thank you for the sense of your presence here. Lord, thank you for the way you're drawing us to yourself. Thank you for the way you reach into people's lives and pull them out of the mire of clay. Thank you for the way you provide for the orphan. Thank you for the way you provide for the sinner. Thank you for the way you provide for each one of us according to our needs. And Lord, we come before you this morning not even aware fully of what our needs are. And as we bask in your presence, we sense that you have something for us. And as we turn to your word now, we pray that you would speak to us, that you would open our eyes to the glories of who you are and the glories of what you do in the lives of your people. In Jesus' name,
amen.
Amen. four is the middle of the story, the middle of the series of events that are taking place. The gospel has been proclaimed. Jesus has died. He's come back to life again. The Holy Spirit has come down. Peter has preached a sermon. Thousands of people have come to faith in Christ. And the church is beginning to operate and beginning to reach out and beginning to devote itself to prayer and to studying the Word and to proclaiming the gospel and taking the gospel to the nations. Peter and John are on the way to the temple, and they see a beggar who is crippled, and he's asking for alms. And Peter says, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk." He reaches out his hand and lifts the man to his feet. He walks. He doesn't just walk. He jumps. He dances for joy. Everyone's amazed. A crowd gathers, wanting to know, how is it possible that this beggar, this crippled beggar, has been healed? And Peter stands up and says, "It wasn't me, it was Jesus." And he begins to preach the gospel and calling people to repent and believe that Jesus Christ is the Savior, that Jesus Christ is the Son of God who died and rose from the dead for the forgiveness of sins, that we can have a restored relationship with God. And he's preaching, and he's preaching, and he's preaching. In verse 26 of chapter 3, it says, "God, having raised up his servant Jesus, sent him to you first to bless you by turning every one of you from your wickedness." And as they were speaking to the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, greatly annoyed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they arrested them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who had heard the word believed, and the number of men came to about 5,000. There's a disturbance in the temple. Peter and John, the apostles, are teaching and preaching. The temple authorities come, they hear what's happening, and they don't like it. The Sadducees were a group of people, rulers in Israel. And they were of a particular mindset. They believed in the first 5 books of the Old Testament. They rejected the prophets, just the first 5 books. They tended to be, we would say, anti-supernatural. They believed the 5 books of the Bible were from God, but they didn't believe in the resurrection from the dead. They didn't believe that was possible. That's a perfectly logical belief. And that's what these people held. There is no resurrection from the dead. To say there is, they said, would be a false doctrine. And they were opposed to it. The Pharisees were another group of people in Israel, the common teachers. They believed in the resurrection of the dead, and this was a common source of tension within Judaism in the time of Jesus. Was there a resurrection from the dead or not? And so when the Sadducees come and they hear the apostles teaching the resurrection from the dead and teaching about Jesus, they're alarmed. False doctrine is being taught. They throw them in jail. The next day, it says in verse 5, their rulers and elders and scribes came there in Jerusalem with Annas, the high priest, and Caiaphas, and John, and Alexander, all who were members of the high priestly family. Who are these characters? Well, one of the things that's really interesting is it says here in the book of Acts that Annas was the high priest. He wasn't. Annas was not the high priest at this time. Caiaphas was. Why does it say that Annas was the high priest? We need to understand what's going on here. The high priests were picked by Rome. They served with their authority and blessing. And there was a man by the name of Annas who got himself appointed high priest. And he was the patriarch of a family dynasty. He managed to have Rome then appoint sons and family members to be high priests after him. And everyone knew who the real power was. The real power was with the patriarch of this dynasty. So he was commonly referred to as Annas the high priest, even though at this moment in history, it's Caiaphas who is the high priest, one of the relatives, his son, I believe, is serving, functioning as the high priest. It was Caiaphas who presided over the trial of Jesus. But it was Annas that was the real power behind everything that was happening. And the family had a lot at stake. They had what would be considered a really good gig. Outside of the temple, there was a whole series of stores. In today's mindset, I would see a series of strip malls, although they didn't have strip malls in Jerusalem. And they were owned by Annas. And it was there that you needed to go to buy things to sacrifice in the temple. They were known as his stores. Not only that, he had franchises set up within the temple itself. Remember Jesus went over and got upset and knocked over tables? They were his tables. We're talking about assembled here in this room to hear Peter and John are the most powerful and influential leaders of Israel. That's who Peter and John get called in front of. Peter, a fisherman, uneducated, made his living throwing nets into the lake and pulling out fish. And he's followed before the most influential family in all of Israel. In verse 7 it says, when they had set them in the midst, they inquired, by what power or by what name did you do this? Who gave you the authority to do this, Peter and John? Who gave you the authority? Now, Peter and John know exactly who they are standing in front of. They are standing in front of the group of people that condemned Jesus to death a couple months prior to this. This is who they are standing in front of. being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, and by what means this man has been healed. Let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. He's quoting scripture to them, a prophecy that the stone was going to be rejected when it was going to become the foundational stone. He said, that's who Jesus is. Do you see it? And in verse 12, he says, and there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. This ran right in the face of everything the Sadducees believed. Ran right against the whole economic thing that this family had going. If Jesus is who Peter says he is, their whole dynasty falls apart. I can't think of a message that would have been more against the status quo than what Peter and John are proclaiming. Salvation is found in no one else. I can't think of a message that is more offensive to our times than this passage. Salvation is found in no one else other than Jesus. He is the only way. We live in a culture that says, build your own religion. Religious smorgasbord. Buffet for you non-Scandinavians. We have an all-you-can-eat religious where you get to pick whatever you want. A little bit of Hinduism, a little bit of Islam, a little bit of some philosopher, your favorite self-help book, roll it all together, pop it in your mouth. That's our culture. But Peter says, salvation is found in no one else other than Jesus. He's the only way. Why? Why does he say that? Peter understands our condition. The condition of every person you meet is they have rebelled against God. They've rebelled against God and are guilty of rebellion against the Almighty Creator of the universe. They may be a good person by the standards of society, but in God's eyes, they are a condemned criminal, destined for hell. We don't like to talk about that in our society. We like the everybody's a winner philosophy. Whatever works for you philosophy. Peter says, no, that's not the way. The reality is, we have all sinned. Fallen short of the glory of God. All of us. And are without hope. Except God, while we were still sinners, sent Jesus to die for us. He came and lived a perfectly sinless life and died on the cross to pay the penalty for your sins. And then God raised him from the dead. God raised him from the dead. price had been paid, so that all who believe in him, all who repent and turn their lives over to him, can have eternal life. This is the sacrifice that God made so that you can be saved, so that you can go to heaven. He paid an enormous price for our salvation. Of course, Jesus is the only way. God does this. We say, you know what? I like the self-help book. This really helps me. And we think, we found a way. Or, you know, maybe I'll try Islam for a while. Oh, that's the way. No, Jesus is the only way. It's God's provided way of salvation. There's found salvation in no one else. There's no other name under heaven. And Peter and John are proclaiming this to the most powerful people who had just seen Jesus murdered. They didn't just see Jesus murdered. They ordered his execution. And when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and perceived they were uneducated, common men, they were astonished. And they recognized that they had been with Jesus. But seeing the man who was seated standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition. We are part of something called the Christian and Missionary Alliance. A denomination, the name describes us pretty well, but it's a terrible marketing name. And all made us just a mouthful. But the Christian Missionary Alliance started around the time of the Civil War. And as a result, there was a phrase that was used about who were members of the alliance. And Peter and John would have fit this description. Alliance people like to call themselves God's irregulars. And it's a phrase that came out of the Civil War. An irregular was a person who got into the army by an unusual means. They weren't fit to serve, they didn't meet the qualifications, but somehow they weaseled their way in to the army. And the Alliance people were known as God's irregulars. People who, when you looked at them, you said, Nah. If I were God, I wouldn't have picked them. They don't have the qualifications. Annas and Caiaphas look at Peter and John and say, who are these guys? We went to school all our lives. We rub elbows with powerful people. We're filthy rich. Who are these uneducated fishermen? They're God's irregulars. Standing there, talking to the most powerful people, proclaiming Jesus. And that's who God wants us to be. It's his irregulars. It's his irregulars. So many of the followers of Jesus throughout the history of the world have not been the elite. They've been common, everyday Joes. Not to pick out the joy. Just common, everyday people. And Angie said it. People are confounded and say, where did this come from? And they recognize these people have been with Jesus. So they have this time of telling power. It's Jesus, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. That's how this person got healed. Then they set them out of the room, which sounds strange, but this was normal procedure. Now they're going to deliberate and decide the fate of Peter and John. Verse 15, when they had commanded them to leave the council, they conferred with one another, saying, what shall we do with these men? For a notable sign has been performed through them, and it's evident to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem. We can't deny it. Everybody knows the beggar they saw every day when they came to the temple. Now he's up walking around. We can't deny what's happened here. But in order that it may spread no further among the people, let's quarantine him. It's like they've got the coronavirus. We gotta keep this thing from spreading and infecting more people. We're gonna order them not to talk about Jesus anymore. Peter and John said, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge. But we cannot help but speak about what we have seen and heard. We cannot help but speak of what we have seen and heard. You don't talk to Cole very long before he's talking about what Jesus did in his life. He can't help but talk about what he has seen and heard of Jesus. Peter's doing most of the talking here, but notice that it's Peter and John both who say, we can't help but speak of what we have seen and heard. John winds up writing a letter. In the first letter of John, he starts with these words. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and have touched with our hands concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest. We have seen it and testified to it. And we proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, that you may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. John said, we're telling you what we have seen and heard about Jesus. And that's what we are all called to do, to tell people what we have seen and heard about Jesus. Peter and John said, you know what? You tell me I can't speak about Jesus. I can't help but speak about Jesus. He came back to life again. I've seen it. He's changed my life. Our society says, don't talk about Jesus. True followers of Jesus, God's irregulars, cannot help but talk about Jesus. We can't help about it. We have to. Because of the radical thing that he's done in our lives, but also because the stakes are so enormous. Heaven and hell hang in the balance. And so we need to be bold and witness. We need to be fearless. Peter and John knew that they could be executed for what they were saying. They didn't care. It was more important to tell these people about Jesus than whatever repercussions might come. And we need to be the same type of people, having the same type of boldness. Anybody here wish they were more bold? Anybody here? I'll be doing it, okay? It's an interesting thing. I used to think, boy, when I become a pastor, I'm going to become really bold. As soon as you become a pastor, you're great, you know, you say, oh, people are going to find out I'm a pastor. They're going to think I'm weird. So I'm not going to talk about Jesus very much, so they don't think I'm weird. I mean, being a pastor doesn't make you instantly bold. You need boldness. So what I want us to do is to pray. Are you willing to pray and say, God, fill me with your spirit and make me bold? Are you willing to pray that day through the prayer with me? If you are, stand up. Father, thank you for this group of your irregulars. Lord, make us bold. Make us bold. Make us fearless. Lord, we have the message of eternal life. We know Jesus. We know Jesus. Make us bold. Lord, fill us with your spirit so that our words are full of grace, seasoned with salt. That they benefit everyone who listens, that they point to Jesus. Oh, Lord, may we not speak long with people until talking about you, pointing people to you. Lord, you are the way, the truth, and the life. And salvation is found in no one.